Duke University graduate student Mark Juhas is seeing muscles and muscle tissue in a new light.
You know, we had them. They seemed like they were in their niche or their microenvironment, so they should be able to function. And I was able to show that they contributed to growth over time. So I figured, why not see if they can actually contribute to regeneration? But yeah, this is one of the more exciting kind of experiments I've ran since I've been here.
We're talking about skeletal muscles. Those are the muscles that enable you to walk in a park and perform countless functions throughout the day. Skeletal muscles are the body's largest organ, comprising 45% of the body. Muscles can regenerate themselves if there is a minor injury. Say that walk in the park becomes too strenuous, or you fall and bruise. But a major injury, say a traffic accident, requires surgery to repair. And sometimes, in the case of disease, there is no option available. Biomedical engineers have long sought to grow synthetic muscle.
And so what the goal is actually to make the one that is really large in size and can, you know, enable walking and other activities that require a lot of force, a lot of contraction. And so building a big muscle is a big challenge. And the reason is that these cells, the muscle cells, require a lot of oxygen and nutrients. And metabolically, we say they're very active.
But all big ideas start small. You're watching individual skeletal muscles about a half inch long, twitching and contracting in reaction to impulses. The muscles were grown in a lab at Duke University.
First, we worked with just creating these in the lab and testing them in the lab. And then once we optimized a model, then we went into an animal.
Turns out the lab-grown living skeletal muscle is, well, amazingly lifelike. Tests show the muscles are 10 times stronger than previous engineered muscles. The engineered muscle also contracts powerfully and quickly, and it integrates itself into the body with other muscles. That's right, engineering muscles in the lab and a living body.
They have a similar outer layer of connective tissue. The interior consists of these, you know, aligned, striated, semi-mature muscle fibers. And then here we're actually showing that we maintain these stem cells that we initially isolate. So they're able to, you know, fuse, create these myofibers, but they're also able to maintain a pool of these stem cells in our muscle, which becomes important as we move on with this project.
It's important because, for the first time, muscle engineered in a lab provided an environment where satellite cells, otherwise known as stem cells, could survive and then activate to heal the muscle.
Daily, we undergo a lot of injuries. We go to gym, we work out, the muscles become sore. What that means is our muscles die. And we do have then these stem cells, these satellite cells, that are otherwise quiescent, are sitting next to the muscle fibers. And at the point when we have injured our muscles, and we do it daily, they jump in, activate, duplicate, and then rebuild the new muscle. So we have this reparative process, regenerative process every day. So muscle is one of our most regenerative organs actually in the body. That hasn't been shown outside of the body before. So this is the first time that we were actually able to generate a muscle that now does have these cells and does have this capacity that when injured, it repairs itself.
The lab-engineered muscle was then placed in the back of a living, walking mouse and monitored. By genetically modifying the muscle to flash when it contracts, scientists could watch the muscle grow stronger.
We actually saw a maturity over time, or increase of this flash over time, showing that we're improving our function of our muscle.
Researchers are now working to see if their engineered muscle can be used to repair actual muscle injuries. The long-term goal is to take a biopsy of an injured human muscle and be able to grow a new muscle in the lab and then transplant that muscle back into the patient.
Maybe the initial step is to go with a smaller muscle, some of the facial muscles that are dysfunctional. For example, muscles around the eye that would give you a droopy eye, right, and or eyelid. And then going to, you know, really trying to replace some of the bigger muscles in the body. We said it's not a tomorrow or next year thing. It's, you know, maybe tens of years, I would say, you know, thing. It's, as I said, the most important thing is really vasculature. If we are able to do that, that would, you know, open the doors for many, right, many things.